I want to introduce our panelists. I'm an employee in critical business systems over on the other side of the river, but I've invited two of my good friends here. I'd like to first of all introduce Bernie Dehler. Bernie is the organizer of the West Side Science and Religion Discussion Group. He's got a BSEET from OIT and a master's in ministry from Luther Rice University. Been working in the computer industry since 1984. He left Christianity and a belief in the supernatural in 2009, but he still has a healthy interest in understanding the Bible better from every aspect possible, as well as learning about all other belief systems. He's a secular humanist, a member of various local humanist and atheist groups. He's actually the vice president of the atheist agnostic resource group at his place of work, although I don't think they actually call them resource groups like we do here. His favorite Bible memory verse is Proverbs 18:17. He who states his case first seems right until his rival comes and cross-examines him. Although he's recently become certified as a humanist minister, he assures me that he is still just plain Bernie, not Most Holy Father. A year or two ago, Bernie's discussion group was looking to broaden its interest, and so he got in contact with Nathan Lewis. And Nathan invited his church, opened up his church's meeting space for Bernie's group and invited the members of their congregation. Nathan is the pastor of Evergreen Presbyterian Church in Beaverton. He's a preacher's kid. He was raised in Brazil and California. Got a degree in English at Biola and a master in divinity at Westminster Seminary in California. 20 years ago, he brought his wife and daughter to Oregon to plant a new church in Beaverton. His family has since grown to 5 children, and that church has been instrumental in planting other new churches in Salem, Newburgh, and Hillsboro. One of his favorite quotes is from Philip Yancey, who said, "No one ever converted to Christianity because they lost the argument." A couple of years ago, he and Bernie got together, and they opened up this discussion group in Beaverton. I'm actually a member of Nathan's congregation, and for quite a while, we actually had not only a Christian presenter and an atheist agnostic presenter, but we also had a Muslim presenter, and it was really fascinating to me. And so when I heard that the training office was asking the different members of the Pluralism Council to organize discussions or dialogues or something to help us do our diversity training event, I thought if I could. Reproduce or try to reproduce the kinds of interesting discussions I've seen in these discussion groups in Beaverton, I think it would be very interesting to you folks and to all of us. Let me say that I have a little bit of a hesitation here, acting as the moderator. In most of these monthly forums, Bernie is the moderator. This last month, he was actually the presenter. And Bernie does a very good job of being the moderator, although he doesn't try to hide his perspective. He makes sure that he asks questions, even pointed questions, not just of the people on the other point of view, but also the people that he agrees with. I should remind you all that these two men are the ideas that they're representing today are their ideas. You should be very surprised it should surprise you to find all atheists agreeing or all Christians agreeing. So keep that in mind. If you're an atheist and you find that you disagree with Bernie, that's probably no more different than, find you're a Christian and you're from a slightly different branch of the church than Nathan is, and so there are some differences there. Our Pluralism Council at BPA has many different groups. We've got an African-American group, an American Indian group, a Jewish resource group. If any of you are of the Jewish faith, I would encourage you to get involved, because I know that group has suffered from leadership in the last couple of years since their president retired. There's the Christian Values group. There's a Disabled Resource group with a Hard of Hearing subgroup. There's the Gay, Lesbian, and Bisexual group. There's a Military Veterans group, a Parenting group, an Older Workers group, a Men's Resource group, and a Women's Resource group. All of us working together to make sure that everyone at BPA feels welcomed. And as Meg was saying, this month the training office has asked each of the groups to organize an event to help us further our to fulfill our requirement to take diversity training. And just another plug, there's a sign-in sheet over here, and if you haven't signed up, you won't get credit, so please remember to sign up. Also over on the table here, oh, it looks like they're all, many of them are gone, but I have some handouts for some of our other months. April is the CBRG's focus group. And also at the end of each row, there's some sheets that have kind of an outline of what's going on today. Our topic today was designed to fit in with the CBRG's April theme, which is love, the foundation of Christianity. So I tried to frame this into a subject that was not specifically aimed at Christians, but something that would be of interest to both Christians and non-Christians. So I've asked each of these speakers to answer the questions from your worldview perspective. What is love? How does your worldview motivate you towards love? And how does this aspect of your worldview make a difference in the workplace? Or maybe how does it, and maybe also how should it? Each speaker is also, I've asked them to take a little bit of their time to talk about upcoming events, to talk a little bit about the organizations that they're involved in and the upcoming events, particularly if there's some upcoming events that might be of interest to people that aren't from their particular worldview. So without any further ado, I think the two of these gentlemen decided that Bernie would go first. Each of them will have about 10 minutes to present, and then after that we'll have some Q&A, first Q&A between the speakers, and then we'll open it up to Q&A from you. So be thinking of questions that will make this very interesting. So, Bernie, you drew the short straw, the long straw, so you get to go first.
Okay, should I take an extra minute, you said, first for an introduction?
Or you may do that. Yeah.
Okay, let me know when that time's out.
Okay.
But, so basically, in the Portland area, there are some places where atheists and agnostics gather if you want to have some fellowship with them. A good place to look is meetup.com. It's a website for anybody that wants to have a group. So if you go to meetup.com, put in your zip code, put in Christian or atheist, you'll see all kinds of groups. One is CFI, Center for Inquiry.
Can I interrupt you for just a minute, Bernie? On the sheet on the end of the aisles, I've got the URL for Bernie's group.
Thank you. Yeah, so basically CFI is one major national group that they have a local chapter in here, Center for Inquiry. Another one is Humanists of Greater Portland. Then they have one called Flying Spaghetti Monster Lands for a Pint. So if you want to meet people for beer and talk about things like that. They have a group called Atheist, etc. So that's a good way to get plugged into the community. And if you're interested in any kind of hobby, it's a good place to go. If you're into knitting or horseback riding, you can find people of similar interests there. So if you type in atheist or Christian, you'll see my groups pop up. There's a West Side Science and Religion Discussion Group and a Vancouver Science and Religion Discussion Group. Okay?
All right.
Okay, so how many people here would say they know at least five Christians really well? Can you raise your hand? Okay. How many people would say they know at least five atheists really well? Can you raise your hand? That's quite a bit, so it wasn't too much of a difference. One of the reasons why I do this is because I want to give a data point, because when I was a Christian, I really didn't know very many other atheists, maybe just one atheist, and actually he wasn't very bright, to tell you the truth, so it wasn't a very good witness for atheism. So here's a little bit of my history. I was raised a Roman Catholic. In college, I left Catholicism I would have said I was just a Christian, because I thought the Bible conflicted with Roman Catholicism, and I was more of and I knew the Bible was supposed to be important, so I was more of a Bible-based kind of Christian. After college, somebody presented me with the Four Spiritual Laws. Raise your hands if you are familiar with that booklet, Four Spiritual Laws. It was one of my favorites. So seeing that, I understood what it meant to be born again, and I was, said the prayer to accept Jesus into my life and was born again. And basically, that booklet is so important to me, I memorized them. You know, the first one is that God offers a wonderful plan for your life, and the rest of them play off that. Ultimately, is we must individually receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, then we can know and experience God's love and plan for our life. I created a internet ministry, which I did part-time because I have a full-time computer job on the internet. I made videos and preached and put them on the internet and local community access TV for a number of years. Then I got a master's in ministry degree while I was working part-time from Luther Rice in Georgia, Luther Rice Seminary. That was 2007, and 2009 I left the faith. This was as a result of talking to atheists and studying the debates. Before, as a Christian, I would debate other Christian religions and things like that, like Mormonism. I had met Mormons and learned their faith and debate with them. The first thing was Roman Catholicism, because I grew up as a Catholic, so I would debate with Catholics about that, learn about Islam, debate with them. So the interesting thing that was about atheists that's different than all the other ones is all the other ones, they start with the belief in God, so you don't even get to that topic, does God exist or not? So when I started debating with atheists, it's like, wow, so a whole different arena here, because now we're talking about does God exist or not? So that was kind of a new experience, and then looking into arguments, you know, for the existence of God. Just recently, earlier this week, I got certified as a humanist minister, so I can now marry people, and I feel that helps me be a better representative. So I have some kind of credentials for that. An atheist, what is an atheist? Well, if you look at the word, not a theist, so it says what you don't believe in, and I want to say what I do believe in. So there's a belief system called secular humanism. Now, if I have more time, and later on, I'll talk more about that. So here's the first question. From your worldview, what is love? Well, from my worldview, first of all, there's no reasonable evidence for believing in anything supernatural, so my outlook is totally natural. I see everything through natural eyes, so there's no spirit, there's no ghost in the machine, so to speak. I could put it this way, too, that our brains are basically biochemical computers, you know, instead of using transistors to compute, they have neurons. So basically, all our mental thoughts, feelings, behavior arise from the brain and the central nervous system. Now, understanding this, sometimes people think, well, that sounds like you're dehumanizing when you look at things like that, because there's such a rich experience that we have the spiritual aspect and all that. Well, one example that people typically use to explain this is, for example, musical appreciation. Let's say, for example, you listen to Mozart and you say, oh, that's such wonderful music. I don't know anything about music at all, but I just love that music. It stirs my heart. And somebody else, a musician, can listen to that music and he can think, you know, I know about notes, I know about chords, I know about rhythm, I know about instruments, and when I listen to that, you know, I'm thinking about the chords and how to transpose it and make it a little different song, put it into a rap song or whatever. So there's a little different appreciation for it. It's a different way of looking at it and a different appreciation. So you wouldn't say that, well, if you're a musician, you know, you're robbed of all the magic, but, you know, it would be a different feeling, but you're not really robbed from it. You might even say you have a deeper appreciation for it because you understand, you know, well, how is it so brilliant putting those chords together and that the way that transitioned and things. And maybe you might say, hey, I created the song and people like Mozart were my inspiration. I saw the patterns he used or his technique and it inspired me to create this brand new thing. So in the same way, you know, we could look at love. I said, our brains are biochemical computers. We have feelings, and these feelings of love are all from natural chemical processes and things like that. So that was from an intellectual position of, you know, what is love? It all arises, there's natural explanations for it. But so now there's like another way of looking at it would be from an emotional standpoint. As an atheist, I would say life is very precious because there's no afterlife. It's not like I'm going to say, let's go off to war, let's fight for God and country. Well, I'm not going to throw away my life because this is the only one I have. Whereas it might be very tempting to throw away your life because, hey, this life is nothing anyway. It's very temporary. We're going to live for eternity in heaven. So, you know, I could sacrifice myself for my faith easily because, there's a missionary had this one saying that he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. So in other words, yeah, big deal, you give your life, you're going to look what you're getting in exchange, eternal life forever, you know? So I don't believe there's an eternal life. I believe this life is it, and so it's precious. I could support war if it was really required, but it'd be like a last, you know, ditch effort. And we could see that we inherited love from other animals. I mean, we could observe feelings of, showings of love in animals if you ever see, you know,
chimps or animals, you know, hugging each other, or your dog. You know your dog when he's very happy and when he's comfortable with you, or if he's in anxiety because you're not around or he's scared. So we can see a lot of these emotions also being played out with other animals. So it's not like, it's easy if you don't look at the animals to think humans are so special. But when you look at comparing things to animals, you see that, oh, well, they have a lot of the same things we do. We just have it to a different degree. Love can be a good thing because it has positive outcomes. For example, feeding the hungry, clothing the naked, etc. But sometimes wrong things are done in the name of love, such as enabling an alcoholic. You know, that person might think they're doing it out of love. So let me give you a little challenge as a Christian. Let me read this. Matthew 38. I can't remember what chapter it's from. Maybe 8 or something. Jesus says, "You have heard that it was said, 'Eye for eye, tooth for tooth,' but I tell you, do not resist an evil person." How many people think that's good advice? Can you raise your hand if you think it's good not to resist an evil person? Including you guys, you can raise your hand if you want to. Is it good not to resist an evil person?
Did Jesus say?
Yeah, Jesus said, "Do not resist an evil person." Okay, so we got a few people that say that's a good idea. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand him over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give the one who asks, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. So I put it in here. Well, actually, no, I would disagree. I think we should resist an evil person. That was acting like a doormat kind of advice. You know, if somebody slaps you, I think you should try to get away or at least defend yourself. The worst possible advice would be to turn the other cheek to your enemy, I think. You can't apply these things to the politics. For example, can you imagine somebody running for president of the United States, and I'm a Christian and I believe we should turn the other cheek. When we got attacked by 9/11, we should turn the other cheek. That person would not get elected or get very far, I think. Even by the Christians. If somebody sues you and you're innocent, should you defend yourself or should you just be quiet and turn the other cheek? Let them take your house and home and your family and all that. I think obviously you should defend yourself. I can imagine a Christian saying, well, that's just because, you know, I could talk to a Christian and say, why don't you just turn the other cheek? Well, that's good advice, but I just can't live up to that ideal. Well, it's not really that you can't live up to it. It's a bad ideal. It's a wrong ideal. If somebody forces you to walk a mile, I wouldn't want to offer to walk 2 miles. It'd be a waste of my time. I got things I want to accomplish in life. I don't want to walk 2 miles just to satisfy some crazy person's control over me. Lend to anyone who asks. Well, you know, there could be beggars on the street corner. Is it a good thing to give them money and, you know, they just go out and buy booze with it? Maybe it'd be better to support a homeless shelter and look at rehabilitation programs. So, but here Jesus says, don't turn anybody away who asks to borrow money from you. So I think all these things, they can illustrate what an enabler has to overcome. It, you know, it's very easy your spouse is sick because they drank too much the next night. It's very easy to lie for them on the phone. But they say, you know, when you take this tough love, you know, tough love is a better example of what you might intuitively do. You might intuitively want to lie for this person, but it'd be better to have tough love, that this person faces consequences. And so that's an intellectual thing. You have to override your feelings. How does your worldview motivate you towards love? Well, some of the good things, one reason why we love is because we get positive feedback from relationships. I mean, if you're a loving person in your family, it makes your family go better. Well, you know, there's more peace in your home with your spouse and your children. Also, as I see everything as part of a nature and you know, we're cousins with the animals, it makes me more acceptable to other people's shortcomings. From a Christian standpoint, you might think there was Adam and Eve, there was this perfect creation and they fell and we need to get back to that. But I see it more like there was no paradise. We evolved from other animals. Now that our brain is more complex, we can do moral reasoning.
And, yes, may I give you 1 minute?
Okay, 1 minute? Yeah. Okay, so thank you. So basically, I can see that, you know, we need to mature. We're going from a lower place, we need to mature and go to a higher place. It's not like we're trying to get back to some ideal place. So in summary, let me just say that secular humanism is an atheistic and agnostic belief system.
I define it this way succinctly in one sentence, that it's a naturalistic belief system that promotes critical thinking and morality by using science and reason. And I like to be, I'd like you to hold that, hold me accountable to that too. I want to be accountable to reasoning. And it's naturalistic. We don't believe anything supernatural. It's not because we don't want it to be true. It's because we don't see any evidence for it, any good evidence for it. And my final admonition is I would ask everybody to try to make a commitment to follow truth with reckless abandon, even place it higher than devotion to God, because Jesus said he's the way, the truth, the life. If it's true and you put truth number one, it'll lead you to the Jesus. And if it's not true, then it'll lead you away from Jesus. So put it to the test. And if Jesus made you, I mean, if God made you and gave you brains, he'd be proud of you for using them to your fullest extent, just like a parent is proud of their children when they bring home good grades. So do not go against your logic and your reason. And I would like to admonish you to make a choice to follow truth with reckless abandon. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Bernie.
Nathan, and you'll give me a 1 minute warning as
I will do that. Let me see if I can make my.
Yeah, because I'm going to need it. The Bible has much to say about love. And from the beginning stories to the very end, love is one of the great themes of the Christian scriptures and the Jewish scriptures upon which they're founded. And so the stories in the first five books of the Bible introduce us to this relationship that God enters into with his created people. And it turns on this term covenant. The covenant is this relationship, this very special relationship that God shares with humanity and with all creation. And so the most repeated descriptive term for the covenant is a Hebrew word that we transliterate and pronounce hesed. And hesed is often translated into English as loving kindness. But most Christian scholars all agree that loving kindness, coming from the King James Authorized Version, is better understood as covenantal faithfulness. So the idea, as we read the stories and as we read the scriptures, covenantal loving kindness is relational faithfulness. And so this becomes the heartbeat, the defining core to what love is for the Christian. And so when Moses, the great prophet of Israel, gives to this people her first codified law, it is centered on the Ten Commandments. And the Ten Commandments is all about love. You say, well, no, it's all about obedience. In the Jewish Christian mindset, there's a very fine line between love and obedience. To obey is to love, and to love is to obey. This is just biblical bread and butter 101. And so the first four commandments teach us how to love God. And the last six commandments teach us how to love one another. Now, one of my ministerial colleagues 20 years ago spent several weeks in a local shopping mall and interviewed on camera shoppers, asking them how many of the Ten Commandments they could recite. And I'll tell you that Oregon as a community, we did miserably on it. So I won't embarrass any of us here today. I'll just tell you that the first four teach us how to love God. No other gods before Jehovah, Yahweh. No making of idols. No taking of God's name in vain. And honoring the Sabbath, God's holy day. So the Jewish community for millennia now have used those first four commandments to teach its adherents how to love God. And then the final six are honor your parents. These are teaching us how to love one another and to respect, and then the New Testament says obey as a translation. So the honoring and respect of parents, which Bernie might think is a bad idea, depending on who your parents are. And then the second one is, the second one in the last number, what am I on, number six?
Yeah.
Do not murder. Teaching us how to love each other. Okay? And then do not commit adultery. Teaching you how to love your partner, your spouse, your most cherished one. And then the next one is, after do not commit adultery, is do not lie, right? Do not bear false witness. Teaching us how to love each other. And then the last one, do not covet. Property, donkeys, spouses. Teaching us how to love our neighbor. So that's the way Moses set it up, these Ten Commandments. These come in to the first century. Jesus gets a hold of them because he's a good Jew. And he summarizes them. This rich young Jewish leader comes to him and asks him, what's the greatest of all the commandments? And Jesus says to him, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. He summarized all ten and said, that's the most important commandment. It's really interesting if you know that narrative with that rich young Jewish leader. He says to Jesus, I've done it. I've kept all ten. And then Mark, in his gospel, he writes, and Jesus loved him. Now, if I ever hear anyone in my community say, I'm perfect, I say, you righteous bigot. Who do you think you are? Don't you know that none of us can keep the Ten Commandments perfectly? And so I'm always checked by Jesus, who looked at this self-righteous young man full of idealism, who had the audacity to claim that he had kept all of God's law. And it says, Jesus loved him. And then Jesus gives him the summary of the law. Now the Apostle Paul, in the next generation after Jesus, when he summarizes the law, he summarizes it, love your neighbor as yourself. Really interesting. And in doing that, and as you read all of Paul, you see that Paul's point is, how do you truly love God, who is in another realm, very present with us, but spiritually so? How is it that you show other people, and how is it that you prove to yourself that you truly love God? Paul's point was, you love your neighbor. You love your neighbor. In other words, the last six commandments are inseparably connected to the first four. You can't say, well, I love God, but I hate you. If you're truly a follower of God, you have to love God and neighbor together. So Paul says, the essence of it is love your neighbor. I find that to be quite instructive. And so here we have this stream of what it means to love in the Judeo-Christian ethic and traditions. And right at the climax of this unfolding history in the Holy Scriptures, at the climax, we have a most important personality who claimed to be love personified, and that's Jesus of Nazareth. And Jesus of Nazareth, the apostles all claim, was the perfect covenant keeper. He's the only member of the human race who perfectly kept the covenant law. He's the only one who has perfectly loved God and perfectly loved his neighbor. And so then the apostles in the New Testament apply all of this to the passionate work of Jesus, meaning his death on the cross. Why did Jesus die on the cross? Well, he died to express his love for the whole world in removing God's wrath and punishment for disobeying his covenant law by taking that upon himself and replacing and giving to us the reward for keeping the covenant. Because Moses said, if you obey God's commandments, then God will bless you. If you disobey these commandments I'm giving you today, then I will surely curse you, says the Lord. And so Jesus is the climax of this whole history, because he who perfectly kept the law of God, loving God and man, he brings it to himself on the cross, and he takes the sins of the world, the failure to keep the covenant. That's love. And so what Jesus gives to us is not only this covenantal faithfulness, which is the core definition of love, but he adds to it self-sacrifice. And this is the great mystery and what we call the gospel, the mystery revealed in the scriptures, is that the covenant keeper gives up his life and gives the rewards of his covenant keeping to all the rest who are failures. And in this self-sacrifice, love reaches a higher dimension or a deeper profundity, that the faithful one is the self-sacrificial one. And so faithfulness and self-sacrifice define love for the Christian. What's the second question, Charlie?
Second question is, how does your worldview motivate you toward love?
Yeah, that's right. So as a Christian, the law, summarized in the Ten Commandments, is a huge motivator to me to love.
And I should say you've got your 1 minute warning.
Oh yeah. So it's a motivator, but I'll tell you, every time I take the motivation and I work toward it, I always come up against my human limitations and imperfections and my sins. And so, as many theologians have noted, the law drives me to Christ. And when I get to Christ, I have to acknowledge that it is his faithfulness, it's his love that matters. And then I see his self-sacrifice for me. And then I get the true motivation for my love, whether it be for my wife or my children or for Charlie or even for Bernie. And that love is motivated by my gratitude to the one who self-sacrificially gave himself for me. And so as a Christian, I'm motivated by gratitude. How does this work out in the workplace? It means that if you follow everything I've been saying and practice in the workplace, you will not be successful. You will not look out for number one. You will have a most difficult time in the workplace, because almost everything, not only in your system as a federal employee, but as a member of the clergy in the ecclesiastical system, it's all dog eat dog. It's all survival of the fittest. It's all looking out for number one. And so we got a problem. Are we going to follow Christ and love and turn the other cheek, Bernie? Or are we just going to look out for number one? We'll survive and we'll be successful, but perhaps we will never know anything truly about love.
Thank you. So our next part of our presentation here is for me to ask some questions of each of our presenters, and then we're going to give them a chance to ask each other some questions, and then we'll open up the last bit of time, last half hour or so, we'll open up for questions from the audience. So be thinking of your questions. So first of all, for you, Bernie, you talked about the problem of you do a good job at this. you talk about the problem of distinguishing between love and dealing with an alcoholic, or what's the word used for that? Enabling kind of love. So, but on the other hand, what is if there is no eternal life, and you're just thinking of this present life, mm-hmm. Is there anything in your worldview that would motivate you to self-sacrifice so that there are those who are around you and you realize that that if you were to do something that would assist them, enabling manner, but in a good manner, mm-hmm. but that helping of them would conflict with what's in your best interest. How does your worldview deal with that mm-hmm. that balance?
It's hard for me to say. I've never been in the military, so it's hard for me to say. But let's say, for example, an atheist goes to war and he believes in this war because there's a good reason for it. Suppose Russia, I mean, maybe what motivates him is Russia says you need to capitulate and be part of the Soviet Union or we're going to nuke you guys. I don't know, maybe some kind of threat like that. And so it's what they call an existential threat. It's a threat to your livelihood or your existence, and so you're going to fight back if it's the only thing. So maybe if an atheist is in this situation and he has co-soldiers with him and they're bonded together because they're serving together, I can see how, you know, you're trained to give your life by instinct because you go through all these training things. So that's just what you do. That's part of your job. You signed up for it and you know ahead in advance that might happen. Now, I could also see that being an atheist, it might make a person a little smarter in thinking about what they do because, let's say, for example, the solution to a certain problem is you can throw yourself on a grenade, or maybe another thing is maybe you can, with a sniper rifle, take out this other guy, and that would also solve the problem. But maybe if somebody's not thinking very detailed, they might just think, oh, there's a problem, jump on it. I'll give my life because they didn't appreciate it so much anyway. So I could see how an atheist might do it as a last resort, but I could also see how they may, you know, it's like if you're in a sinking boat, somebody said, Bernie, wouldn't you pray to God if you're about ready to sink, you know, and there's nothing else you could do? I said, well, there'd be no point in it. For a person right away to go to praying to God for help, they might have an opportunity cost there where they could have thought, oh, well, maybe I could do something to survive. And, of course, you hear from the people who say they prayed and God delivered them, but you don't hear from the people who say they prayed and they still died. So these people saying, see, I got proof God helps me out because this happened, this impossible situation. You know?
And a question for you. Now, this is where you can really tell that I probably don't measure up to Bernie, because Bernie, when he's asking questions of atheists, he'll ask really pointed questions. So we'll see if I can ask a pointed question of Nathan. So what of this deal about enabling love? So why would, you know, if you're really supposed to be self-sacrificial, and then why would you not, you know, what would keep you from doing what the other person wants you to do? Why would you not just be a doormat and turn the other cheek and call in for work to your spouse that was drunk and hungover? Isn't that what you're supposed to do?
As I think some of us probably know in the room, the scripture's full of detailed instruction. And any of it or the stories, what Bernie quotes from the Bible or what I quote from the Bible, has to be contextually understood. So we do have the large picture themes for and definitions for love being faithfulness and self-sacrifice. But I can quote for you scriptures where we are cautioned to not be naive and not to be an enabler, to be wise about what we do, to have a stewardship of love, if you will. So, you know, to turn the other cheek or to go the extra mile are references that Jesus is giving in his Sermon on the Mount and we can find it with time. I could supply you with the contextual immediate reason why he said those two commands. They're not principles that would prevent us from protecting our loved ones against a perpetrator, you know, preventing us from restraining a thief who comes into our home, or never in any situation retaliating. When it comes to enabling someone who is in bondage to some addiction or something, there's plenty of scriptures that would apply, that would give a full-orbed a service to that person, like speak the truth in love. Or to warn a brother once and warn him twice and then to bring discipline upon him. Or to cover that person's failures, and to do as much work privately as possible so that that person is not publicly shamed. But these are all biblical teachings from the New Testament that would, I think, aid us in this.
Okay. Now we're going to give each of you a chance to ask the other, who wants to go first? You want to ask Bernie, or Bernie, you want to... You can duke it out and see who gets to ask the first question.
I can go first.
Okay, go ahead.
One thing I wanted to mention, there is... I would like to say some positive things, too. There's... How many people here have heard of a book called The Five Love Languages? I think it's Gary Chapman wrote that. I was introduced to that as a Christian, and I would like to say that's brilliant when it comes to love. And actually, you'll notice there's not one scripture verse in there, but he is a Christian, but it's just an awesome book, I think, to really explore how to be a loving person. And when I was taking seminary courses, there's this guy named Harley who... We studied...
Just a minute, Bernie. Okay. This is the place where ask a question of Nathan.
Okay, you're right.
And we want to make sure that we demonstrate to the audience what we expect them to do when it's time for them, that they're going to ask a question, not give a large extended statement.
You're right. Okay, so...
Even though I really was, you know, I'd like to hear more about that.
Yeah, you're right. Okay, so... let me give you an example. Let's say, for example, you're the dictator of the America. For some reason, there was a problem with the presidents and the whole political system. We say, we need a dictator right now. And you're it. You're the dictator of the United States. You can get whatever you want to. We want you to do the right thing for us. Let's say a bunch of people are lobbying to have the Ten Commandments to be invoked as a law of the land. And you could do that and get away with that if you wanted to. Would that be a good idea, you think?
No, I don't think so. I think to superimpose that upon... The only way to use the law of God properly is to, as an individual or as a worshiping community, submit to God's infinite holiness and justice. Submit and say, He has the right to make these laws and to enforce them. And then to allow those laws to drive you to Jesus and to call out for God's mercy through Jesus. To do that in the sphere of the state, mm-hmm. and to superimpose that or to impose that upon everyone, it's the same thing that has happened historically with Christians and Muslims at blade or gunpoint, forcing people to follow God.
So are you saying then that there's no country on the face of the earth that if they wanted to institute the Ten Commandments, that would be a good idea? If some country arose somehow and said, we have this movement, we're going to instigate the Ten Commandments, you would go on record against that?
I would not be in favor of it, no.
Even if it was Israel, for example?
No, I'm not a theonomist. And you know, we started with Charlie's clarification that I don't speak for all Christians, and I have really good friends who are theonomists.
But if it was,
they believe that God's law should be established in modern states.
Well, I'm just thinking if that was a superior moral code and everything, why wouldn't you want to instigate it? If it's superior to everything.
I think constitutional America is a beautiful example of Christian and non-Christian minds coming together and creating a document that has the light of the Ten Commandments in it, but is not the Ten Commandments.
So now it's your turn, Nathan, to ask Bernie a question.
Yeah, Bernie, do you have any books, especially Christian books on love, that you want to recommend and talk about?
Yeah, a softball one. Yeah, like you said, the five love languages is perfect. And also, in seminary, I took this marriage and family course, and everybody had this idea like you need to become Christ-like, that's good counseling. But this one guy was different. And he says, you know, to fix marriage, it's all about love. And you can do things to promote love, and there's things you can do to hurt love. It's called love busters. And he didn't have any scripture anywhere. It's just all common sense. It's like, love is what makes it go around. So it's like, you really don't need love, or you don't need God for love. It's kind of interesting how these were Christians that put this forth, but it's not really Bible-based.
I have a question that I'd like to ask each of these two guys. One of the things that has impressed me over the months of knowing the two of you and seeing you talk together in similar venues is that, Becca, you know, when I grew up, I learned that there are three things you don't talk about in public: sex, politics, and religion. Just in polite conversation, we don't talk about those things. And I think that one of the reasons why we don't do that is because so often those discussions degenerate into unpleasantness. But what is it about your worldview for each of you that has allowed you to come together and talk with someone that believes so very differently from you, and yet do it in a kind, in a respectful way, not minimizing your differences, and maybe even accentuating your differences, but yet you do it in a way that is friendly. How is that possible?
Well, I'll tell you, when I was a Christian, one of my favorite slogans was, "It's all going to burn." First or Second Peter talks about how everything, when Jesus comes, everything's going to get burned to a crisp, and new heavens and new earth. And so don't get attached to this world, you know. But given that, how should we live our lives? As an atheist now, I still say it's all going to burn, because the sun is getting bigger as it burns, and it's going to eventually fry the earth. Everything's going to be gone. If everybody in the world becomes a Christian, a born-again Christian, or a Muslim, or a Jehovah's Witness, or whatever, you know, in the big scheme of things, it doesn't matter to me. I mean, it doesn't matter to anything, because everything's going to get erased. So basically, I enjoy living for the moment. Now, to know that the big picture, nothing really matters. Some people say, that could be depressing. Well, it could be depressing. It could also be liberating. It's depressing, especially if you come from an attitude of, I'm going to live forever. Oh, my gosh, now I'm not going to live forever. But if you grew up with it, knowing that we're temporary, it's something, you know, it's coming to that area of acceptance. So anyway, the bottom line is, I'm not here to, I mean, I enjoy the intellectual exchange, and I'm here for educational purposes. Whether people change or not, I don't care. So I don't need to get upset and mad. Why would I get upset and mad? It's not like I'm going to be able to keep anything anyway. So,
okay. Nathan? Well, I'm a pastor by vocation, and so my concerns are primarily for the people I serve. I want them to live free of fear. So I don't want them to fear other worldviews. I want them to live with a love and appreciation for other views, and not to become cloistered or to put blinders on. I want them to live their faith in a world where there are many different worldviews being lived out. And so for that to happen, I have to make space for other views to be spoken. Also, I am called to be an evangelist. So I have the title Minister of the Gospel in our national church. And so it's also my duty and privilege to help the congregants I serve to be apologists and to be evangelists. And many Christians, when I ask them, including members of my congregation, how many non-Christians do you have substantive relationships with where you can have conversations about what you hold dear? And people are so busy and taken up with family and friends and only Christians or only non-Christians that this polarization needs to be broken down if we're going to share real ideas across worldviews. So enter Bernie into my life and a few other people, and we are able together to create space. But what motivates me to love Bernie is that I truly believe that Bernie is body and soul made in the image of God, and that God highly values him, even though Bernie denies his existence, that he is a creation of God, and God looks down and says, I have a high value and an inestimable value upon your life. So that motivates me. If I'm going to follow God, I can't say Bernie's trash. I can't ignore Bernie, because Bernie came into my life, and I into his, and we're creating this space for the exchange of ideas, and I value that as well.
Okay. All right, well, let's open it up to the audience here. Anybody have any questions? Yeah.
Any questions?
Yeah, actually, let me, I have a few things I'd like to say ahead of time. Sorry for cutting you off. let you open the door and then I shut it again. So the first thing, I want to make sure, you know, I'm the moderator, and so is it self-centered of me to ask you to respect the moderator, and I'm going to try to move the discussion along. A couple of things I want to do. I want to make sure that everybody has a chance to ask a first question before we go on to asking second questions. And I want to make sure that when you do ask questions, that you ask a short question rather than a long sermon followed by something that has a question mark at the end. So we want to, you know, do it that way. We want to try to follow. I'd like you to try to follow the example of these gentlemen. And you know, I don't know whether you guys are the Christian persuasion, another religious persuasion, or non-Christian persuasion, but let's. You know, we're here in the workplace, and I think it's okay for us to discuss things, and particularly if we can do it in a respectful manner. So, with that, go right ahead.
So, you mentioned you're involved with science and religion and those kind of concepts, and I kind of got the idea that as you get more and more scientific or logical or a deeper thinker, that you would somehow. That would lead you to ignore religion more, or it would be less, you wouldn't believe it because you've now found science. And so I was wondering if you could go into that a little bit. Does knowledge somehow mean that you're now less, that you should be a secular humanist because you now have more knowledge than...
Yeah, so when I was a Christian, one group that was really beneficial for me was called ASA, American Scientific Affiliation. It's for Christians who are in science, and there's a lot of professors, seminary professors, and academics, biologists, and stuff. And I kind of went through all the stages. I kind of started off the most literal interpretation, like a young Earth creationist. And then as I saw more evidence against that, I went to the old Earth creationist, and then finally to the evolutionary creationist, because I accepted evolution, trying to make that fit in theology. And then the person who I thought was the best role model for that wasn't, I don't think theology made sense, and it was just too mystical, and I said, no, I got to follow my brain. I don't want to just say it's a mystery when it looks like a conflict. You know, someday we'll find out in heaven. Well, we don't really have to wait. I mean, you have the information now to make the decision, I think. So that's why I left.
So you think that the knowledge means, well, I guess what I'm saying is if people gain knowledge, does it mean that they can't be a Christian anymore? Do you think that they're denying their knowledge by being Christian?
Well, so like I said, the group that I like, I had some good discussions in there. And so, you know, all of them will say the young Earth creationists, for example, will say, hey, they're perfectly aligned with science. The problem is the modern science is wrong. The correct science is called creation science. We interpret science totally different. So they all think they have no contradiction with science. Personally, I do believe the more you learn, I mean, I think I had the right path, and if you keep on learning more, you're going to follow my path, too. So, but I know Christians who accept evolution totally, and, you know, the one guy said, that's total garbage to say science conflicts with religion. Look at me, I have 3 PhDs, 2 in science and 1 in theology. Well, yeah, but I do look at you, and I see how there's problems, and you just basically go to a mystical thing where it's all about Jesus and the Bible is not about science or history. It's basically, it's just what you can get out of it. If you like this confirmation bias, look at all the good stuff, and that's the stuff you dwell on. If there's questions and difficulties, just put that out of your mind. Just pray and, you know, feel close to Jesus. That's what it's about. And I don't want to go there. I want to use my mind, too. So,
another question. Yes.
Yeah.
And I should say, you're welcome to, as this question was directed to Bernie, you can ask a question that's directed to one or the other, or you can ask a question that's directed to both. And if, you know, let it, I think we can kind of guess, but if you want to make that clear, you can do that.
I guess it would be Bernie, or anyone can really chime in. This is somewhat hypothetical, so don't freak out. So I'm thinking about becoming a criminal, or engage in some sort of business practice.
I'm glad this is hypothetical.
That takes advantage of other people because, you know, I can really advance myself. Mm-hmm. And I'm good enough at it where I won't risk going to prison or anything like that. Well, from a secular humanist standpoint, why wouldn't I want to do that if I can better myself? And we're all just, you know, this chemical substance that's known to creation. Why wouldn't I pursue that if I could get away with it? And there's a good chance that I could, and I could really improve my life. I could get a nice house. You know, I could cheat on my wife if I wanted to. I could do all these things. Hey, you know, it's a pretty good party. And if I can do so and still, you know, hold all that together and not go to prison or suffer consequences, shouldn't I go for that then if I'm a secular humanist? It seems like that's the way to go.
It's a good question. I think that would be a long discussion, too. But it's a really good question because it really is based on consequences. I mean, if there's any chance of getting caught, you go into jail, you ruin your life, you ruin your relationships, you ruin your heritage. It's, you know, everybody in the family knows about you. You can't get another job and all this stuff. So it really does come down to a lot of consequentialist kind of thinking. But the other thing I want to mention is when I was a Christian, I opposed Pastor Hagee out of Texas because he's a TV minister. And I tried to do a petition to get other Christians. Look, this is terrible. He's pulling over $1 million salary from his church and ministry. It's, you know, and he could think, hey, there's millions coming in, takes them off, and it goes out, nobody's going to know. And I tried to tell other pastors, nobody really cared. And it's like, why are these people doing this kind of stuff? Well, because like you said, they can get away with it, and they are getting away with it. So that was very frustrating to me, is like, why can't the pastors even stand up and say this is wrong? We don't believe in covetousness. Well, he doesn't love money. Well, then why is he pulling $1 million out of his ministries? I mean, come on, he's supposed to be a minister. So.
So I suppose I shouldn't tell you how much I make.
most pastors don't make very much money, I know. It's most of them are poverty level, probably, so.
Do you want to add something to that, Nathan?
No, I think it's a really good question. It's a question that I've heard, and it's, you know, for me as a Christian, the motivation is more than a motivation. It's a person, and it's the lawgiver who says, this is the true way to live, the true way to love. Follow me, and you'll know what true life is, what true love is. So for the Christian, it's very clear because the person of God is there. For other worldviews, it's, I think, like Bernie says, it's a bit complicated, and it would turn into a very long discussion.
Okay. Can I add something?
Sure, please.
So like on this Pastor Hagee situation, you know, like when I was a Christian trying to confront this, I could see a lot of people saying, like, well, he's a fellow brother. You should try to confront him in person first. Well, I did. He wouldn't take my telephone calls. I can see people saying, well, this is not a very loving thing to do, to be judgmental like that. But is it more loving to try to reform the movement, try to reform Christianity by saying, look, here's an abuse, let's reform this? So, I mean, I was very frustrated that pastors cannot stand up to this. So
he was taking advantage of
there's a question here?
Yeah.
Do you have a question?
I just was commenting that it seems like he was taking advantage of the people that were supporting him, his congregation.
And also the ministry. It's a 501c3 nonprofit organization. If you send a dollar into them, you're now a donor, and you can say, I want you to use my money wisely. You know?
Mm-hmm. So your point is that the question that you were posed about what would prevent an atheist or a secular humanist from doing this, your point is that apparently, at least in some cases, the Christian worldview doesn't prevent them from behaving in the same way.
Well, I'm saying too that I can see from a Christian perspective, they might say, don't be critical. That's not loving. And you might argue, well, isn't it more loving to try to be a reformist and confront this evil thing that's going on? But it seems like that's going against the flow, where the flow is don't condemn, don't judge. Nobody made you the judge. Okay. It's not your place. And
all right. Okay, another question from the audience.
Got a veiled question.
Okay, go right ahead.
Wouldn't you agree? So empathy
So is how does empathy fit in? Mm-hmm.
So the way I see empathy is basically when we're in a bad situation, we feel pain. And empathy is feeling somebody else's pain because we have a cognitive ability. When we see somebody starving, we know what it's like to be hungry. And so when I see somebody starving, it hurts me. And so when I give them a money, then my hurt goes away. And that's what empathy is. It's basically doing something about pain. So that's how I see it. So yeah, it'll make you feel good.
Uh-huh. So wouldn't the sociopath be the most healthy person there? Because then they aren't victim of these other people, and victim of all these other things in mm-hmm. society that hurt them. So people that we regard as being mentally ill today, the sociopaths, they're actually the best people because they're not subjected to all these dependencies on the other people.
They have a terrible life too because nobody likes them, nobody wants to hang around with them. But what you want to do is, when you want to find out about consequences, you don't look at just one person. I think you want to look at generalities. Like, for example, here's a person who wants to kill and rape people at will. Okay, how's that going to be in our society? Well, that's not going to have good outcomes in our society. So you don't want to look at it from the perspective of me, like, oh, I want to kill and rape somebody. Hey, I can get away with it. Okay, that's good. You want to make it more abstract, look at it as a third person thing. That's a basis for looking at morality. Is looking at the big picture from a third-person perspective.
Right, but wouldn't that just change from day to day, though, because things are constantly in flux, and, you know, what's okay one day is not the next day, then the next day it's something else, and you know, there's no real, it's like a car without a steering wheel.
Well, that's the way it is. I think, really, ethics are situational. You can look at some things that are obvious. For example, rape is always wrong. Why? Because you define it as sex against somebody's will. So, but a lot of things, like, for example, is killing wrong? You can't say killing is always wrong. Sometimes it's the best thing to do. If there's a person taking this whole group hostage, and he says, I'm going to start killing everybody in 1 hour, and there's a SWAT team out there, and they say, I have a clear shot. Should I take him out? Yeah, it's morally correct to take out that killer before he kills other people.
Actually, if we have a situation like that, since this is the emergency command center, we have to leave. So the Richard.
It kind of follows on to this train of logic, but you were talking about, Bernie, you were talking about turning the other cheek. And generate my question, but basically, did not Jesus, in a number of his talks, like turning the other cheek, bring up a principle that we should follow in many cases? The example I want to say is, if two people are arguing one another, are getting ready to fight, you can each stand up and say, I'm right. Each person can stand up and say, I'm right, and stay at odds with one another. But I think many times what Jesus said is he'll give a principle, and it's when you think beyond it, you realize, oh, there are sometimes when someone is adamant and against you, it is the best choice to turn the other cheek. They may get the better of you once or twice, but they may realize, oh, you're a better person, and it will change them. So aren't there many things in what Jesus said that there's a principle behind it that you would want to follow?
Well, so in this specific instance, I think it's easy to turn the other cheek if it's something that you don't really care so much about, like, we'll let this go on their side because it's not that much of a consequence. But let's say, for example, you have high-stakes consequences on it. Why would you want to turn the other cheek? I mean, and turning the other cheek isn't just giving in. Turning the other cheek is offering more punishment. I mean, he didn't say walk away or anything like that. He said turn the other cheek. It's not. And if somebody wants to steal your coat, give them something else too. Say, here's my iPhone, you want that? I mean, he's saying go the other way, you know? I mean,
doesn't that sometimes, in the end, create mental anguish in the aggressor?
Well, see, I think the thing is Jesus didn't have to worry about worldly consequences. I mean, he basically sacrificed his whole self. He didn't have college savings, didn't have retirement. I mean, look at this guy who said, hey, look, I did everything. And he says, he looked at him and he loved him. And he says, one thing you lack, go give everything and sell to the poor. Well, who could do that? Nobody can do that. Was he just saying a principle, or was he asking him really to give everything to the poor? Well, Jesus gave everything to the poor. He gave his whole life out. He had no family, no kids, no, didn't need college savings, didn't need anything. But it's, you don't want to tell people now to sell everything and give to the poor. I don't think that'd be responsible. But some people might do it and say, and they might have no qualms about begging for money. I'm a missionary. Can you please support me? I gave everything for God. So can you please help me on my mission? It's like, it's kind of a begging mentality too, I mean, to some extent.
Nathan, would you have any?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I agree with what you're saying about Jesus' words, and it, you know, Bernie has a natural science education, and I have a humanities education. I have a degree in English literature, so I think I'm just a little bit more in tune with how to interpret words. Where Bernie, in our talks over the last couple of years, seems to have difficulty with hanging on to his Christian literalism. So he thinks that turn the other cheek means in every single situation, he has to take the brunt of someone's hatred, act it out. And Jesus isn't saying that at all. I think you're coming closer to it. You know, what Jesus was telling the rich young ruler was, you have to follow the first half of the commandments and love God above all other things. And so I detect in you, you still have an idol that you worship of greater value than me. You're worshiping wealth. And so you need to give it away. And you're going to say, well, see, you just figuratively explain away anything. But what happens is if you interpret any of us in this room, 80% of what we say consistently every day, figurative in its language, you are not going to understand what we're saying, who we are, and what you ought to do in response. You won't get it. What you will do is you'll take my words and turn them into blithering idiocies. And so we have to listen to each other. The words are tools, and the language comes alive when we see the whole context of it. And so, you know, I'm just trying to get some job security here. As a minister, I work more with words, and Bernie, he works more with cells or with chips or, you know. So there's a place for both of us.
Can I give a comment on that?
Sure.
Anybody, I could see anybody's, everybody, you could say everybody has a problem with money being an idol, and I could prove it. I would say, prove you don't have a problem with it, sell everything you have and give to the poor. I could say to you, do you have a problem with money? No, I don't have a problem with money. Money is not an idol. Okay, prove it, go sell everything and give to the poor. Can you do it? Can you sell everything and give to the poor?
Well, if Jesus said that to me, and he probably ought to say that to me more often, I would begin to work more and more to use the money I have in a way that would be glorifying to God, that would promote his will and his ways in this world, to use everything that I have to serve him and others.
So
I would take that as an exhortation.
So you're kind of lucky that Jesus didn't ask that of you.
No, because when I hear that text, I take it to heart myself. Because just as you said, mm-hmm. probably most of us in the room have difficulty with putting a proper value and priority on our money. So when I hear that, I'm brought up short quite often.
Some people, sure. You know, mm-hmm. a lot of people really do take it literally and seriously, like Mother Teresa maybe, and then they're in a situation where they have to beg for money because they don't have their own.
Well, you know, in your Roman Catholic heritage, the orders, the Benedictines, they would take my view and say there's nothing wrong with wealth, we will amass it and we will use it to God's glory. But then the Franciscans took vows of poverty, and they went the way Mother Teresa did. In Christendom, there's plenty of room for both of those to serve Christ. There's beautiful examples of very wealthy Benedictines and orders that have done some wonderful work in this world. And then who can argue with what Mother Teresa's done? If Mother Teresa came and begged me for a buck, I would give her 20, if not 2,000. And I think a lot of people in the world would because of her vow of poverty.
How about in the red first and then the black?
I would really like to know from both of you your definitions of faith and forgiveness.
Nathan?
Well, I believe, you know, the Apostle Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus in chapter 2, I think verses 8 and 9, that faith is a gift from God, so that I would not boast that I had manufactured something that would win God's favor. And so that gift that God has given me is the ability to use my mind to believe that what he says about himself in this world and about me is true, and that I can accept that and rest and live with it. For me, forgiveness is also biblically defined, and it is agreeing that what has been done against me is truly a sin against God and against me. And I'm willing to follow Christ in, as he said from the cross, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. So even if someone has maligned me in ignorance, I am willing to take God's love and say, I will not count this against you. I still have a memory, don't I? I'm going to remember what's been done. But like with my wife of 22 years, I have promised her that I won't bring it up. Even if I have a memory, I won't bring it up. And you know where I've learned about that experientially? From her. Because she never throws it in my face. That, for me, that's forgiveness.
Say, Bernie, your definition of faith and your definition of forgiveness.
Yeah, I think faith and forgiveness are good. Let me tell you, so I think basically faith is, we all know, so there's certain facts in the world we have access to, and there's a lot of things we don't know because we don't have information for it yet, and so we extrapolate from those facts. Given these facts, this is probably true, so that's what our faith should be based on the facts. One of the abuses of faith is when you say, for example, things can be contrary to your senses. For example, there's a certain Christian denomination that says, when the minister does a consecration, this bread turns into the literal body of Jesus, even though it doesn't taste like it, see it or anything. It just is literally the body of Jesus, even though it contradicts all your senses. I would say that's a bad thing of faith, because that's not a good faith, because it contradicts your senses. So that's an abuse of faith, is when it goes contrary to evidence. And the good faith is when it's built on the evidence. As far as forgiveness, again, forgiveness, you know, it's very healthy to forgive people to go on with your life. Otherwise, it kind of eats you up inside. But then there's a unhealthy kind of forgiveness. For example, if you live with an abuser and he beats you, and then the next day he comes to you and says, oh, please forgive me. Okay, I'm a Christian. I should forgive you. You're forgiven. Next day you get beat again. And then the next day again, it just repeats over and over. You should forgive me. Well, you know, there's a higher level thing that should take course, where you say, you know, I need to be responsible. Yeah, I forgive you in the sense that I'm not going to hold a grudge against you, but I'm not going to put myself in that situation anymore. And they might say, like, well, then you haven't truly forgiven me. You say, well, you know, I have, but, you know, you have to have a healthy look at it.
So. And your turn now.
Yeah, so basically, there's kind of a movement in secular humanism. It's having a global perspective. So basically, yeah, you know, that's one of the problems with morality in the past is that there's these tribal things. Like, you know, the fact the people of Israel, that's the prime example. Our God is the real God. These other gods aren't. This is our tribe. And, you know, don't kill. That means don't kill people in your tribe. But if you kill others, that's okay, you know, especially for God's purposes or something. So now we need to have a more planetary approach. We're all humans. You know, we need to learn how to get together. So I look at it as a global approach. So I'm not really so much USA. I'm more of the world kind of person. It bothers me when people say America's the greatest nation. We need to keep it that way. I'd say, why don't we focus on trying to make the world a better place, really? And the second part of the question, about helping other people. What was it? Yeah, I mean, I get pleasurable feelings, I guess. When I was a Christian, we sponsored a kid through Compassion International, and I'm not a Christian anymore, but we still sponsor these kids. And, you know, I'm helping a kid in poverty go to college right now. I you know, it makes me feel good. It's an extended family member in the Philippines, you know, so.
Would you consider helping a kid in the
U.S.? Go ahead.
I think the question there is kind of stemming from a tribal kind of thing, is if the U.S. is more important. It seems like the U.S. has such a safety net where people do not suffer. I kind of like take some pleasure in helping somebody who's even more in the dirt road. I mean, for example, this woman we're helping go to college, if she gets a good job, she's going to actually help her family also out of poverty and maybe, you know, other people too. So I take more pleasure out of it by helping even more desperate people myself.
Nathan, I want to give you a chance to respond to those questions.
Yeah, I mean, just briefly, I'm ever grateful that this is my passport here that I had to get into this building with. It's a U.S. passport. And I believe that for some reason God allowed me to be born in Grants Pass, Oregon. So I'm an Oregonian. I'm a U.S. citizen. That's important. If I know if someone from Grants Pass needs help, I help them. There's because I have some kind of relationship, even just in the listing of my birthplace, as opposed to Baker City, Oregon. So I'm going to do what I can to help, but I'm involved in a different citizenship. My citizenship is in the kingdom of God, and that's a global and a universal citizenship. So I agree with Bernie. And I think the church largely practices this global charity, because we're all members of the human race. And so we go across those lines. But I'm still a nationalist. And I don't think there's anything that is wrong with being a nationalist. I think that you would have to show me a different system that would bring all the peoples of the world together in peace and harmony that look different than national systems. I mean, you know, governments. You come up with something else, I'm open to it. But fundamentally and primarily, I'm a citizen of the kingdom of heaven, which is really difficult for me because the Apostle Paul says that even right now, as a brother of Christ Jesus, I am seated in the heavenlies, and that this no longer is my place of citizenship. So, you know, I'm torn because I'm supposed to follow God and do what's right in this world, but I'm not supposed to be so entangled in it that I forget where my true home and citizenship lie.
We've got room for one, maybe two more. Yes?
Me?
Yeah.
Yep, okay. Nathan, in your opening comments, you said something about it's difficult to succeed at work if you put love as a priority, that it's a dog-eat-dog.
Yeah, right.
So does that assume that the majority of people in a work environment are not loving or are self-serving?
No, I don't think so. I think that as a community, we've worked really hard. And I believe in the doctrine of common grace, which says that God not only endows his faithful followers with goodness, but all of his creatures. So I think we've worked really hard, but that's just my point, is that we have to work hard to do it. It doesn't come naturally to us. If we're left just to the primal, animalistic drivers, if we are purely animal, then we're left to survival of the fittest. We're left to the dog eat dog. We have to rise above that to our higher virtues and our spiritual faculties to do something that would be loving in the workplace. We have to work against it. We have to, in other words, it's not natural for us to think of anything else but the bottom line for me. This kind of a gathering here, I think, is very important in a federal building. You know, I think that's significant. I think, you know, where Bernie works, he can't tell you where that is, but where he works, there's a lot of stuff going on that works against these principles that tear down one another for the self. I mean, selfishness is natural.
Do you think it's more prevalent in a work environment than a home environment?
Yeah, I do. I think because just relationally, like I can come to work, I can come to my cubicle, I suppose, and pretend that I'm less connected to you than my children. And less accountability. The smaller the circle, the more accountability, usually. So there's more people holding me accountable in my family and extended family. Same thing in church. I'm in a tight box at church. I'm in a fishbowl, man. I'm held accountable there. In the workplace, I can come in, do my job, and get out, and I can screw the person next to me in the cubicle. Because there's all sorts of confidentiality. I can go and say things confidentially over here, I suppose, and screw him over.
I'm furrowing my brow just because I do have that sense of family at work as well.
That's wonderful. You're working against it. That's, yeah. And I do think there's a lot of progress that way. Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm not really convinced either. I don't think with your position either that if you're a loving person, you won't be good in the workplace. But I could see some religious ideas that would kind of be self-inflicted. For example, if it's like, okay, what'd you do? Let's say I need to promote one of you guys, and you're the real humble Christian. You go, oh, pick him, because he's better than I am. I'm nothing, you know. So I could see some self-inflicted damage that would be maybe from unhealthy Christian thinking. But like where I work, it's usually very merit-based. And so if you're a hard worker and you get along well with people, that's actually a plus. And I think you could get promoted quicker. But if you're going to be self-deprecating, like tell your boss constantly, I'm nothing, you know, I'm not important, I don't need anything, then I could see, you know, kind of self-inflicted problems there.
Well, we're drawing to a close here. I see there's one more question, but before we wrap up, I want to remind you that if you want your diversity credit, you have to sign in on the sheet. And also, I'm going to send an email to the people on that list with a feedback survey. And if you would, you know, I'd appreciate it. I'm the one that runs the surveys, and I'd appreciate it if you do that. It gives me, you know, it helps me feel good about myself. But also, I think both of these guys have a little bit of free time, so I want to be respectful to everyone's time, and we'll close at 2:30. But if you'd like to come up and continue conversation for a while, we've got the room scheduled for a while, and we can do some more. So if you want to come up and ask your question individually, that would be fine if you haven't got another meeting. So thank you very much, and I appreciate your time.
Thank you.